Good morning, church. Please join us as we sing our call to worship. Please stand.
Seated. Good morning, church. I want to welcome each of you to our church services this morning. Especially want to welcome our visitors and remind you to fill out a little visitor's card you can find in the pew in front of you if you are a visitor, and place it in our offering plate. Our pastor today is not here. This previous week, past week, he's been in Kentucky to some pastors' meetings, and he will be back next week to be with us. I want to draw your attention to a few of the announcements that you find in our bulletin. First of all, you'll notice that there are a couple of announcements concerning outreach and mission that our church is working on in the community. I invite you to read those and prayerfully consider how you may be a part of our church mission in our community. Also, our July Vespers is coming up on Friday, July 8th, 7 p.m., so you want to mark that date on your calendar and make sure you're here for that. The title sounds like it's interesting: social media, the brain, and spirituality. So you won't want to miss it. I also want to draw your attention to the section of our bulletin that is concerned with Mayfair Christian School. There's news there that we have two new teachers that will be coming very soon. Also, there are some other announcements concerning work bees and volunteers needed, but I want to draw your attention to the one where there's a financial opportunity, or a giving opportunity for us. The school is replacing some of their playground equipment, specifically the swings and possibly their climbing gym. Now, I moved here almost 50 years ago, and I can remember those same swings at the school at that time. So I'm sure those swings came with the school when it was built back in the mid-60s. So those two things, the swings and the gym, have deteriorated to the point that they are a safety concern for our kids at the school. So they need to be replaced, and you'll find the opportunities there that you have for helping out to cover the cost of the swings and the gym. So keep that in mind. Also, now I want to invite Karen to come forward to give an announcement concerning Vacation Bible School.
Good morning. I just want to make sure that it's at the top of your mind, your mental task list, that you should volunteer for Vacation Bible School this year. I still need volunteers to make this week a success. I need teen volunteers, high school age especially. I need adults. I need lots of people to come out and help to make this week a success. But don't forget, you guys need to invite children to VBS too. Okay? If you haven't signed up yet for VBS, there are lots of easy ways to register for Vacation Bible School. If you like the old-fashioned pencil paper method, there are forms in the hall out by the bulletin board that you can pick up, or there are also some flyers there where you can get the QR code and scan it in and go ahead and sign up online, whichever works for you. But don't forget, sign up for VBS, come to Vacation Bible School, and be a volunteer at Vacation Bible School. It's going to be a lot of fun. We're heading to the Southwest with the cactuses and the big, incredible rock formations that you can find down there. And it's just going to be a lot of fun where we learn about how great God is. Come and join us.
Happy Sabbath, church. Thank you. Most of you may recall the Akron Area Interfaith Council Hunger Walk that was held last month. For the past 4 months, I've had the pleasure and honor of working with Leela and Leonard. I realize there is more that meets the eye in the execution of such an event. I have seen up close the dedication and commitment that Leela puts into this event every year. It has been a wonderful experience to work and learn under Leela and Leonard, and I'd like to thank them for their hard work and dedication for this event over the many years they have been running it. A quick statistic for you all, the entire Akron area as a whole raised $25,942.08. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
Leela and I, with our talented videographer, Leonard, have prepared a video with more information. I hope to see our church in larger participation with more donors and walkers in the coming years. Thank you so much and have a blessed Sabbath.
Hi, I'm Leela, and I'm a member here of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. I've not been to church now for a little over a year due to illnesses that I have had. But we still wanted to give you a little report on our hunger walk that we just did in May. So anyway, I'm going to turn this over now to Brooklyn.
Hi, my name's Brooklyn, and I'm also a member of the Akron First Seventh-day Adventist Church. And it's been my pleasure to be working with Leela to help organize the wonderful community service event that is the Hunger Walk.
Okay. First of all, we would like very much to thank all of the walkers that we had the day of the walk. We really represented our Akron First Seventh-day Adventist Church well. In addition to the walkers, we had, who was it?
Sponsors. We had many sponsors in this year's Hunger Walk, and I'd like to thank all the sponsors and the donations that were given for this year's Hunger Walk. It is a great way to help serve our community.
Yes. Sorry for the delay in trying to get this report out to you folks, but we were waiting for the final figures on the Hunger Walk through AAIC, that's Akron Area Interfaith Council. Believe it or not, we're still waiting for the figures. I did get a call from someone last night, and they told me that they still do not have the final figures in. We know, as our church, what our final figures are, but apparently other churches outside of Firestone Park and businesses, apparently they have not gotten their monies into the AAIC yet. But I tell you, as soon as we get the figures, we definitely will let you know. Our church actually had the figures the very day of the walk. We never slow down in trying to get our monies in, because the deadline should be and is the day of the walk. Well, the day of the walk, we got our monies right into AAIC. Now, Brooklyn, can you give us a little report?
Yes. So in previous years, our church raised $1,555 in 2020, $1,355 in 2021, and this year's amount was $1,550 in 2022. Again, I'd like to thank our walkers and our sponsors, and you made our church smile and represented us really well.
You know, I'd like to take this opportunity too to thank Brooklyn. This young lady actually stepped right up to the plate and said that she would like to work with me on this community service. And I was so happy and so pleased that we were able to work together. Now, she comes all the way from Worcester to my home here, and they've made like 3 or 4 trips so we could get all of this together, because she started coming even before the walk. And due to health issues on my part, I've not been able to be active as far as getting out into the community, but I do my work by telephone and by Zoom. And this is one thing that we're going to start getting Brooklyn involved too, because she has said that she would like to take part and do more of this work for the community. And it just pleases me that our young people will step forward like this and be good leaders and an inspiration to other young folks. So if you know any young people that really would like to take part in any programs that we have here at the church, tell them to tell their parents and have their parents come to us and let us know that they would be willing to work. Now again, we're so thankful for all the work that went into this. The walkers, the sponsors, people don't realize the amount of work involved. And again, it couldn't be done without Brooklyn helping me this year. And of course, we were very kind. She doesn't have driver's license yet, so she has to depend on Dad to bring her up here to my house. And so we have to give appreciation to him and a big thank you. So again, thank you so much for participating in our Walk to Stop Hunger. We really appreciate it, and it's a wonderful thing to serve our community. Thank you so much, and God bless.
Let us begin our worship service with prayer. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the blessings that you've given to us. We thank you for this beautiful day that we have you have given to worship you. We pray for your presence, be in each of our hearts, be in each of our minds, we ask. Touch us with your love and your mercy that you have for each one of us. We thank you for all of these things. Amen.
Okay, please join us as we sing our first song, 461, Be Still My Soul.
Yeah.
song is God on the Mountain. Our last song is 449, Never Part Again.
Thank you. today's offering is for the Ohio Conference Advance. Have you ever planned ahead and saved your money for something special? Maybe a new bike or something even bigger, like a new house or car? The Ohio Conference Advance is a way of planning ahead for the future of our conference. These funds are used for things like camp meeting, camp Mohaven projects, improvements in schools and churches, evangelism, and so much more. Your offering can make a difference in the future of our church and the Ohio Conference. Please mark your tithe envelopes for Ohio Conference Advance to support this important mission. Will the deacons please stand? Let's pray. Dear God, please bless this offering today. Please help it to be used to spread your love throughout Ohio. Amen.
It is now time for our children's story. I want to invite the young folks to come down front for their story and their time together. And remember, as adults, this is our chance to help them with our offering we have for Mayfair for the students. So this time we will have our children's story.
Good morning, boys and girls. I think they're sleeping a little bit still. Let's try that again. Good morning, boys and girls.
Good morning.
Oh, okay, they're awake. Today, I'm going to read you a little story. It's called The Perfect Fit. Does anybody know where our perfect fit is? Well, we'll see if we can figure it out by the end of the story. This is Triangle. Triangle loved rolling with the circles. But sometimes she felt a bit different. The circles didn't mind when Triangle accidentally bumped into them, but Triangle did. She felt like she was getting in their way. So she decided to find somewhere she could truly belong. Just around the corner, Triangle discovered some squares. Come play with us, the squares said. So Triangle did. They played all sorts of games, and it was terrific. Let's build a tower, one of the squares suggested. So Triangle hopped up to help. But they all came crashing down. Sorry, Triangle cried. It's okay, said Square. We don't mind. But Triangle did. She didn't want to spoil their game. She shook her head. I need to find somewhere. I fit perfectly. Around the next corner, Triangle found some hexagons. Do you want to play? They asked. Triangle nodded. There were so many games Triangle could play with the hexagons. It was lots of fun. Let's make a pattern, the hexagons suggested. Triangle joined in, but she kept making the pattern different, not the same. We can play something else, the hexagon said. But Triangle decided to say goodbye and keep on going. Triangle searched and searched, but couldn't find anywhere she fit perfectly. She started to feel very fed up. Maybe there aren't any other triangles. Maybe I'm the only one. But then she looked up and thought she saw a familiar shape in the sky. You're not a triangle, are you? Triangle asked. Almost, but not quite, the star said. Triangle sighed. Don't worry, there are shapes that look exactly like you, and they're not far away. Finally, she found them, triangles that were exactly the same as her in every single way. She rushed over to join them. Together they played lots of triangles games. It was wonderful. What should we do next? One of the triangles asked. But none of the other triangles knew how to roll. As Triangle tried to show them, she thought about all the fun she had with the other shapes, and it gave her an idea. You found the others, the star called down. I did, Triangle replied, and we had lots of fun. But I realized there was something missing. Everyone else. I used to think I didn't fit in with shapes that weren't like me, but then I realized how much fun we're all missing out by not playing together. So would you all like to play with me? The shapes were very excited. They all had a terrific time. And even though Triangle wasn't exactly the same as everyone else, it was still the perfect fit. So it's kind of like here on Earth. We're not exactly the perfect fit by ourselves, but all together, when we get up in heaven, it's going to be the perfect fit. Would anybody like to pray?
Dear Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for this Sabbath day. And please bless everyone that's in this church. And thank you for giving us this Sabbath day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Now, boys and girls, you guys are going to stay up here for your guys' song that you're going to sing next.
Okay, At this time, I'd like to invite the junior early teens and any other children from our children's divisions to come on up and join us. You guys that are already up here, go ahead and stand up on the step where you are. If you're taller like Brooklyn, maybe you want to head to the back. And I'm going to invite our junior early teens, taller children, to fill in behind them, okay? Our children's divisions are busy places, and today we just want to honor them a little bit and acknowledge that things are changing because children grow and develop and change. And in the summer seems like a great time to transition to the next class. So we will honor some of these boys and girls today as they are promoted to the next level in their classes. But we are going to begin with our song that we have practiced. I have Peace Like a River, and let's sing it with our whole hearts. Thank you, boys and girls. Now, if we talked about you guys staying because you're being promoted, stay here on the stage. The rest of you, go ahead and go back to your parents. Thank you for sharing your song with us today. And I want to invite the teachers to come up at this time. All right, so we have quite a few kids being promoted to a new grade today, a new class. All right. Okay, I think we got it figured out. Okay, so we have four different children's divisions. The first one is the beginners, and that's ages zero, like, but when they're babies, they're welcome to come. So if you have a new baby, come and join us. They start seeing the bright colors and the smiley, happy faces first and listening to the songs. And then by the time they're reaching and holding things, they can play with the little toys and just have fun with us. And as they get older, about the time they go into kindergarten, they're just really going in the Sabbath school and just having so much fun. And I just want to promote or recognize today some of the little ones who have been promoted either just very recently or right about now. So Emma Drury, is Emma up here? I think she's disappeared. Okay, she has had a birthday here in June, and she has or maybe it was May, and she has moved on to kindergarten. So I'll save that for Emma. Oh, there's Emma right there. Hi, sweetie. All right, so congratulations. You are ready for kindergarten Sabbath school. All right, another one is Trust. And Trust has learned about Jesus and how much he loves him in our Sabbath school and is ready for kindergarten, too. There you go, Trust. And Levi, he graduated, let's see, I think it was about January he moved on over, but we just want to recognize him and give him a certificate. He's completed our beginner class. You two can go ahead and go sit with your mommies or daddies or whoever you're with today. All right. And then kindergarten, I'm going to invite our kindergarten teacher to come on up, Ms. Venice. And
Okay. Boy, you know, I didn't want to see you guys grow. Why do you grow so fast? I mean, I just get to know you, and then you have to leave me. Oh, well, it's for a good cause. And I'm glad you're growing up in the church, and you still love Jesus. Well, my first one that will be parting is Sammy. It was a pleasure having you in class. And I just hope you continue to prosper, okay?
Okay.
Gonna miss you. My second one is Bennett. Bennett is my serious little one. He just looks at everybody and will just smile. It was a pleasure having you in class, and I know you're going to find it much more exciting when you go up to kindergarten, to primary. Okay? Thank you, and everything of the best for you. And then I have Jordan Frankie. Oh, this was my singer. Whenever I needed somebody to sing, it was Jordan. It was a pleasure having you in the class, and I wish you all the best, okay? And continue singing, because that's what I enjoyed. Thank you, big guy. And then I have Sandmeyer, who we didn't have for very long, but it was a pleasure having you in the class, and I hope you and wish for you to have a real prosperous next few years, okay? And thank you for being in the class. And then Nurki. Nurki was my silent one. But when called upon, he would always give us the correct answers. It's a pleasure having you in class, Nurki, and I'm really going to miss you children, okay? Thank you. And then Gabriella. I remember when Gabriella was just a little girl, and this is how big she is the next time I see her. Children grow too fast. It was a pleasure having you in the class. And thank you very much, and I wish you all the best, okay? Thank you. Oh, where's the teacher gone to? And our next teacher now.
All right, our primary class is Mrs. McCullough, or Susan McCullough, so come on up.
Hi. Okay. Well, good morning, and not quite goodbye because I'll see you around, but we have students who are moving on to juniors. We're so want to welcome all our new primaryers. They just got their certificate. We have students moving on to juniors. I know that Jaden has been in there and has been a very willing helper at times in Sabbath school. Jaden, here is your certificate. And smart. We've enjoyed talking with you and listening to all your comments and questions and watched you grow, learning how to look up things in the Bible. Here is your certificate. Edison. I thought Edison was here. I don't know where Edison went. Okay. Oh, Edison's at camp. Innocent was here. Oh, I can't tell him apart either. Anna's not here. Gary, we have quite a few that are moving on, but sometimes in the summer, not everyone attends. Okay, Delise. Delise, it's been a pleasure having you in class and watching you grow. And here's your certificate. Angelina sometimes attends at Canton, so she's, I think, helping lead the music at Canton today. Camilla is also not here, I don't think. Is Camilla here today? I don't see her in the back. Okay, and so we also have the Damson boys who have been with us when they were little. I remember them when they were little. And they moved away, but they've come back for the summer. And I didn't know, so we didn't make a certificate for you. But we'll have to get you one. We talk with Mrs. Frankie, and we'll get it. We'll get your name on one for you in a little bit, okay? Before you leave church, maybe? Okay, yeah. So we're good. Glad to have you here, and we'll enjoy seeing you around this summer. But I guess they're moving on to juniors. So, okay, thank you.
Okay, and our junior early teen is led by Sue Kirschbaum.
All right, well, we just have two students that are just completed the eighth grade and going into the ninth grade, so they'll be joining the youth department, and we definitely will miss these two as they provide much help with music and just participation in general. So we will give to Brooklyn Shellacotton and to Melody Mackey, and we hope that we still see you around.
Thank you. Our children's divisions are a wonderful place. If you have not been a part of it and you have little ones, or if you know little ones that would like to join us, we would love to have you.
Good. I still remember. Happy Sabbath. We're so grateful for the children ministries and all other ministries and the good work that that is being done here. And it's time for prayer. I'd like to read a text as we move into prayer. And there are a number of requests in your bulletins. I think they should be, or sometimes they're up on the screen as well, that I'd like you to remember. I'd like us to do prayer a little differently today. I'd like to ask for your help. I'd like you to pray, and so we'll... I'll give you a few minutes to pray individually, or you can choose somebody who's next to you that you pray together with them for a few minutes. After you pray, I'll give you a few minutes to pray, and I'll start singing Sweet Hour of Prayer. When you're done praying, you can join me in that song, and once we're done, I'll offer a prayer to close. So there are a lot of prayer requests here in relation to people who are struggling with different ailments. There's prayer requests on to do with mission and the mission work that the church is doing. I'd like us to pray for our children as well in the church. There are requests on the second to last page of your bulletin from the Mayfair Christian School for Nolan Johnson, Jacqueline, and Hito and Miss Haddix. Include those in your prayers together with all the requests that you see up here. So I'd like you to just pick a name or two and pray for those for a few minutes, and then I'll conclude with prayer. 2 Timothy, 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. Let me see if I can... Let me get the King James Version. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. I'll read verse 1 and then I'll jump to verse 3. I exhort, therefore, that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God, our Savior. And so I'll give you a few minutes. Just pick somebody next to you, or you can pray by yourself for a few minutes. And when you hear me start singing, it's time to wrap up, and then I'll close with prayer from up here. Just assume any position that's comfortable for you.
Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer that calls me from a world of care and beads me at my Father's throne, makes all my wants and wishes known. In seasons of distress and grief, my soul has often found relief and oft escaped the tempter's snare by thy return, sweet of
everlasting Master, you who created everything, that which we see and that which we cannot see, out of nothing. And you formed man of the dust of the earth and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and he became a living being. And you who, even after we sinned and wandered far away from you, sent your son to be born of a woman and to die that shameful death on the cross, that through his death we might have life, the more abundant life. We cannot be grateful enough for your greatness, for your mercy, for your love, for who you are. We cannot be grateful enough. Yet we still say thank you because of who you are. Thank you, Lord, for the breath of life that is still within us. And thank you, Lord, for making it possible for us to come to this place that is called by your name, for to worship and to hear your word. Thank you, Lord, for the prayers that have been presented before you this morning by this congregation. Your children have cried out on behalf of many who are sick, on behalf of our children, on the behalf of our pastors and our leaders. And Lord, I want to pray for every person who is within earshot of my voice, and every family that is represented here. We ask for a special blessing upon them all. We ask, Lord, that you may meet every need in accordance to your will and in accordance to your riches and glory. We want to ask, Lord, that you may continue to shape and prepare us for your coming. May you continue to mold us into the likeness of Christ, that when you come, we will be ready to join you. I want to pray, Lord, for Elder Lee, whom you have chosen to deliver your message today. He is only a weak vessel, but we know that a weak vessel in the hands of a powerful God is a powerful thing. And so we pray that you may give us a message in season for every heart, a message to draw us closer to you, and a message to enrich and build us in our spiritual walk. We want to ask that your will be done in all things, and where we've gone wrong, we ask for your forgiveness, and may your kingdom come quickly. Remember each name in the book of life, and Lord, may your Holy Spirit always intercede on our behalf on all things, because only he can present requests on our behalf, for we know not how to pray, but he presents them in groanings that cannot be uttered by human tongue. We thank you, Lord, for hearing us this day, and we thank you for the blessings that you have in store for us. And we pray that your will be done above all things. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
God has used the Old Testament to teach Old Testament world about the coming of his Savior. When we think of the Old Testament and its lessons about God's grace and forgiveness, we most likely think of the sanctuary system and its ceremonies that pointed to the Savior God who would die for the sins of the world. But God also used the lives of prophets and kings, boys and girls, patriarchs, and everyday people to symbolically teach those people of the lessons of Jesus. But those accounts of past events were also meant to give understanding to us of the grace and forgiveness that God provides for each one of us. These Old Testament stories continue to inspire, and today's sermon is a familiar Old Testament story, the story of Jacob and Esau and a mistaken identity. Let's pray one more time for God's Spirit. Heavenly Father, we pray for the wisdom that comes only from you as we open your word. Send your Spirit, give us wisdom, understanding, knowledge. May we find Jesus and the story of your salvation that you give to us in these pages that we study. We ask for your presence to be not only in this room, but in our hearts and minds as well. Amen. I'd like to pick the story up by turning to Genesis chapter 27. We'll look at the first four verses of this chapter. It starts out, where it says, "And it came to pass when Isaac was old and his eyes were so dim that he could not see, that he called Esau, his older son, and said to him, 'My son.' And he answered him, 'Here I am.' Then he said, 'Behold now, I am old. I do not know the day of my death. Now therefore, please take your weapons, your quiver and your bow, and go out to the field and hunt game for me, and make me savory food, such as I love, and bring it to me that I may eat, that my soul may bless you before I die.'" Here we see that Jacob, Isaac as an old man, is planning to bless his eldest son, Esau. We notice in here, in this ceremony that he is preparing for, that there is eating and drinking, and it is a special part of all religious services. Isaac could not convey the blessing until he had eaten the meat provided for that purpose by him who was to receive the blessing. We find that the birthright blessing was very important. It was part of the promises that God first made to Abraham when God made his covenant with him. The birthright was usually reserved for the firstborn son of the family. And the birthright included not only inheritance of earthly wealth, but also spiritual prominence. He who received the birthright was to be the priest of the family. And he who inherited those blessings was to devote his life to the service of God. Also, the Redeemer of the world was to come through the owner of the birthright. In other words, the owner of the birthright was part of the lineage of Christ. Now, I'd like to stop for a minute and take a look at how Esau, the elder son, viewed the birthright. We know that as the elder son, that he was entitled to the birthright. But we also know that Esau had no inclination for a spiritual life and lightly regarded the blessings that went along with the birthright. We know already that Esau had traded the privileges of the birthright with his brother Jacob for a bowl of soup. On the other hand, we find Jacob, who was desiring the future blessings of the birthright, and he sought the honor that came with communing with God and being part of God's family of the promised Messiah. But as Isaac spoke these words to Esau, stress and conflict arose in the family. You see, Rebekah, Isaac's wife, had overheard his instructions to Esau. Now, Esau was Isaac's favorite of the twins, but Jacob was Rebekah's favorite. And Rebekah knew that God had a plan for Jacob with the birthright. So let's turn back a couple of chapters in Genesis and see what God had told her. She had been struggling in her pregnancy with the two boys, the twins. They had been struggling with each other, and she could feel it in her womb. So God spoke to her. She asked God about it, and in verse 23, the Lord said to her, excuse me, two nations are in your womb. Two people shall be separated from your body. One shall be stronger than the other, and the older shall serve the younger. Now, from this we learn that God had chosen Jacob, the younger twin, to be the stronger of the two boys. This wasn't because God was being arbitrary in who he decided that he was going to bless, but it had more to do with the fact that Jacob was more interested in spiritual things. He enjoyed the communion with God, and he sought spiritual leadership that were part of the birthright blessings. And it's not difficult to realize that Isaac was could not have been ignorant of the divine purpose for Jacob, but his natural affection for Esau caused him to impart the honors and powers of the birthright to his elder son. And since Rebekah knew of Jacob's plan, and knew of God's plan, she was going to make sure that God's plan was carried out. And she would make sure that Jacob received the birthright blessing. To her, the end justified the means. In other words, she was going to do whatever it took to get the birthright blessing for Jacob. God just wasn't moving fast enough. Where have we heard this before? Well, we don't have to think too far back in the Old Testament from Genesis 25 to remember the story of Abraham and Sarah. You know, God had promised a son to them, but it wasn't happening. At least it wasn't quick enough for Abraham and Sarah. So Sarah knew that for sure she was going to have to help God out on this one. And you know the story. You know, remember the story of how Abraham was convinced by Sarah, his wife, that he should take her maid as his wife and have the promised child through her. And you also know how well that worked out. Now, we're still struggling with that decision today in our world. Now, it wasn't out of the realm of God providing a person, a son, as a firstborn who was not born first. We find examples where God reassigned the birthright, although it hadn't happened yet in the biblical narrative. Jacob's own firstborn son did not receive the birthright. We read in 1 Chronicles chapter 5, verse 1 and 2 about Reuben, Jacob's firstborn son. It says, now the sons of Reuben, the firstborn of Israel, he was indeed the firstborn, but because he defiled his father's bed, his birthright was given to the sons of Joseph, the son of Israel, so that the genealogy is not listed according to the birthright. Yet Judah prevailed over his brothers, and from him came a ruler, although the birthright was Joseph's. So even in Jacob's own family, the birthright was transferred to from Reuben, the firstborn, to Joseph and his sons. Although the kingship and the rulership of the tribes of Israel eventually went through Judah. And we also see in David the same thing happening. God declared David to be his firstborn, even though David was the youngest of his father's sons. Psalms 89:27, we find that God is telling David that I will make him my firstborn, the highest of the kings of the earth. David receives this distinction because of his position, privileges, and responsibilities as king. So here we see some examples of how God works out this birthright blessing when the circumstances are such that the firstborn rejects or for some reason does not receive the blessing. So let's go back to our story. We find Rebecca, and she's making a plan. She has to act pretty quick because Esau is already out in the woods and he's hunting for the meal for Isaac. So let's go to verses 8 through 10 of Genesis 27 and read her plan. Now therefore, my son, obey my voice according to what I command you. Go now to the flock and bring me from there two choice kids of the goats, and I will make savory food from them for your father, such as he loves. Then you shall take it to your father, and that he may eat it, and that he may bless you before his death. A plan for Jacob to lie to his dad and get something that didn't belong to him. What could go wrong with that plan? Well, even Jacob saw some holes in it. We read on in verses 11 and 12, Jacob says to Rebekah, his mother, look, Esau, my brother, is a hairy man, and I'm a smooth-skinned man. Perhaps my father will feel me, and I shall seem to be a deceiver to him, and I shall bring a curse on myself and not a blessing. Yeah, that's a logical question. What happens if Dad figures out I'm not Esau? So, as we look at this, it's interesting that Jacob's misgiving about this plan is not the evil of deception, but with the fear of getting caught and the consequences that go with it. Isn't that often how we work? We don't mind doing evil so much, but we don't like the part about getting caught for doing evil. But Jacob's mother told him not to worry. She had it covered, and she would even take the hit for the curse. Her attitude was, Jacob, just do as I say and get the goats. But Rebecca really didn't think about the part about the curse either, because she couldn't really bear the curse for Jacob's wrongdoing. Only Christ can do that. And we need to remember as well that it is only Christ who has borne the curse of the sin for each one of us. So now Rebecca has made her plan. Now it's time to start executing it. So we read on in chapter 27, verses 15 through 17. Then Rebecca took the choice clothes of her elder son Esau, which were with her in the house, and put them on Jacob, her younger son. And she put the skins of the kids of the goats on his hands and on the smooth part of his neck. Then she gave the savory food and the bread, which she had prepared, into the hand of her son Jacob. Everything was ready to go. He had Esau's clothes on. He had the goat skins on his hands and his neck and his chest, so he felt like his brother Esau. So Jacob went in to his father, and since his father couldn't see very well, but he could hear him, and he said, who is there? And Jacob lied, I am Esau, your firstborn. When Isaac asked him why he was returning, or how could he return so quick with the food, Jacob announced that God had brought it to him. God was in this. Isaac seemed to accept that answer. So far, so good in the scheme. It was working. So now let's continue. Let's go to verse 21. Let's look at verses 21 to 23 of this chapter in Exodus, or in Genesis. It says, Isaac said to Jacob, please come near, that I may feel you, my son, whether you are really my son Esau or not. So Jacob went near to Isaac his father, and he felt him and said, the voice is Jacob's voice, but the hands are the hands of Esau. And he did not recognize him, because his hands were hairy like his brother's Esau's hands. So he blessed him. So we find here that Isaac isn't so sure about this, that he's not really sure if this is Esau or not. You know, the voice sounded like Jacob, but the skin felt like Esau. It reminds me of a time when I was back when I, a story that started when I was in college. I got to know Rob Vandeman when we were both students at Union College, and Rob was studying to be a minister. We were both part of a group of guys who worked at the desk in our dormitory lobby. You know, we did things like answer the phone, take messages, sort the mail, welcome guests, those sorts of things. And eventually we graduated and went on our separate ways. And we graduated at different times, but eventually at a 25th year reunion for Rob, he was asked and invited to be the guest speaker for the weekend. And one of his close friends, or he had an interesting story with one of his close friends, which Rob related as he spoke that weekend. He said when he got on the campus of the college and he first met his old friend, I believe was his roommate, he was kind of surprised. You see that as often happens when we get older, Rob had acquired some extra weight since his college days. So when his close college friend met him, he remarked, the voice is Vandeman's, but the body is somebody else's. And so as a joke, Rob's friend pretended to be confused about Rob's identity. And likewise, Isaac was confused about Jacob's or Esau's identity. He had the voice of Jacob, but the hairy body of Esau. So again, Isaac asked Jacob who he was. Are you really my son Esau? Jacob lied again. I am. Isaac was now convinced that Jacob was Esau, and Isaac blessed him. Jacob had passed the test. Isaac called for the meal that initiated the blessing ceremony, and Isaac was a victim of mistaken identity. Let's look at the blessing that is recorded in chapter 27 of Genesis. It starts in verse 27 and goes through 29. It reads, and he came near and kissed him, and he smelled the smell of his clothing and blessed him and said, surely the smell of my son is like the smell of a field which the Lord has blessed. Therefore may God give you of the dew of heaven, of the fatness of the earth, and plenty of the grain and wine. Let people serve you, let nations bow down to you, be master over your brethren, and let your mother's sons bow down to you. Cursed be everyone who curses you, and blessed be those who bless you. This reads very much like the covenant that Abraham was given from God many years earlier. You know, the dew of heaven speaks of material abundance. The blessings focus on future wealth and posterity, most profoundly seen in receiving the blessings of Yahweh's covenant blessings. So with that, I'd like to stop our story right here. Let's concentrate on what has just happened. First of all, we notice that there are some similarities between this story and the story of the fall of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. Both stories are about food. Both stories are about a lie. There is also a covering. There is also a blessing and a curse. God's grace is found in both stories. So it's interesting that these two elements play out in both of these stories. You know, the story of Adam and Eve was the downfall of man and the start of sin in this world. And Jacob's sins covered the same elements that are found in this story. So we look at Jacob here, and we don't see a pretty picture. He lied to his dad. He pretended to be his brother, which was really another form of lying. And then he stole a birthright from his brother. Because of his part in his mother's theme, his father mistook him for his brother. So there he was, standing in his brother's clothing, and Jacob received the blessing of the firstborn. This blessing did not belong to him, and he could never earn it. Therefore, furthermore, this blessing was rightfully belonging to his brother Esau. We could look at Jacob and think, well, what a crook, a dirty scoundrel, dirty cheater, you know. What an awful thing he did to his family members. But let's stop for a minute. The longer we look at Jacob, the more he looks like us. We are Jacob in this story. And I like to look at some of the characters of the story and how they fit into our experience. First of all, I want to look at Christ as our firstborn. You know, as a creator, Christ is considered the firstborn of all creation. If we turn our Bibles to Colossians chapter 1, look at verses 15 and 16, we read of Jesus. It says, "He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created that are in heaven and that are on the earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created through him and for him." So here we see a picture of Jesus as the firstborn. Now Christ is the source and the force of creation. It doesn't mean that Jesus was this was a record of Jesus' actual birth, but it deals with the privileges and the rights and the resources of a firstborn son. We also find in Revelation chapter 4, verse 11, and speaking of Jesus, it says, "You are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they exist and were created." So here we see the power of God through Jesus being manifested and praised and honored, because Jesus was the creator of this earth. The redeemed will worship him in heaven because he was the creator of all things. So here we see Jesus is considered the firstborn of all creation. Next, if we go on in Colossians chapter 1, look at verses 18 through 20, we find that as Redeemer, Christ is the firstborn from the dead. It reads, "And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he may have the preeminence. For it pleased the Father that in him all the fullness should dwell, and by him to reconcile all things to himself, by him, whether things on earth or things in heaven, having made peace through the blood of his cross." Revelation 1:5 also speaks of Christ as the firstborn of the dead. It says, "Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler over the kings of the earth, to him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood." So we see Christ as the firstborn from the dead. If we go on, we also know that we have the hope of the resurrection, because the resurrection of Christ makes our resurrection possible. Christ is the legitimate firstborn. As we go on and continue looking at this story of Jacob, we come upon the idea of the fact that our sins are covered by Christ's blood. Jacob had a covering of his firstborn brother, didn't he? But we also have a covering that is provided by our firstborn, Christ. 1 Peter 2:24. It reads, when it's talking about Jesus, it says, "Who himself bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, having died to sins, might live for righteousness, by whose stripes you are healed." So here we see a picture of Christ dying on a tree. Not that he deserved to die, but he died to sins so that we might live to righteousness. He had taken our place for the things that that we had done wrong. We read also in Isaiah chapter 61, we find a verse that speaks to Christ's coverings. Isaiah 61, verse 10, says, "I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with ornaments, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels." So we are covered by Christ's robe so that we get what was rightfully his, not what we deserve. No matter how hard we try, even by lying and stealing like Jacob, we can never become a firstborn, because as Isaiah points out a couple pages over in chapter 64, verse 6, "But we are all like an unclean thing, and all our transgressions are like filthy rags. We all fade as a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, have taken us away." But in turn, Romans 5:8 says, "God demonstrates his own love toward us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." So we are covered by Christ's blood and his robe of righteousness, just as Jacob was covered by his brother's robes, the firstborn of his family. So right in the middle of the story of Jacob lying, cheating, stealing, we find the story of Jesus, the gospel story right there in this Old Testament revelation of a family problem. Now, Jacob claimed to be someone that he was not. Joseph claimed the privileges of the birthright before his father. But Jacob did not deserve those privileges. Now, notice the irony of Jacob. Jacob, even while committing his sin, standing there lying to his father, he was covered with the clothes of the one who deserved those privileges. Likewise, only Christ can rightfully claim the privileges of the firstborn, and likewise, we can claim forgiveness of our sin and the privileges of the spiritual birthright only when we are covered by Christ's robe of righteousness. Jacob meant his covering for evil, but Christ gives us his covering for good. I think of another story when I was back in college, way back when. I was a sophomore in the spring of 1968. 1968 was a presidential election, and Robert Kennedy was running for president. And he was coming to Lincoln, Nebraska. He was going to the field house at the on the campus of the University of Nebraska there. And I had a friend, Bob, who also had a friend who had press passes to get into the field house to see Kennedy. And Bob asked me if I wanted to go see Kennedy that afternoon, and I said, sure. That afternoon found us on the campus of the University of Nebraska, finding the field house and then trying to find the door for press passes. Eventually a certain door was unlocked, and Bob entered the door and went in. I followed Bob, but a man at the door stopped me. He wasn't going to let me in. Well, here I was kind of lost. What do I do now? How do I get in? I don't have any press pass to get in. What's going to happen? Bob will get in. I'll be outside. The hundreds, thousands of people around. I never find Bob again. I probably wouldn't even get back to school because I'd lose my ride, because Bob was the one that drove us to this event. But just at that time, Bob turned around and he said, "He's with me." And the man said, "Okay," and let me in. So when Satan rightly accuses a believer of being a sinner not qualified for the blessings of the birthright, Jesus says, "He's with me," or "She's with me." If we're with Jesus, we are qualified for the blessings of the birthright. Twice in our story, Isaac asked Jacob, "Who are you?" Twice Jacob said, "Esau." Now years later, when Jacob was wrestling with God, Jacob asked God to bless him. And now it was God who asked Jacob, "What is your name?" This time Jacob answered, "Jacob." This time Jacob told the truth. The name Jacob means supplanter or supersede and replace. Simply put, Jacob means deceiver. Jacob now recognized himself for who he was, a sinner in need of the Savior. Only when Jacob recognized his need could God bless him. And as a result, God blessed him and changed his name from Jacob to Israel. He went from deceiver to overcomer. How do you answer the question, "Who are you?" Are you a deceiver trying to hide who you are? Are you claiming to be someone you aren't? Or do you admit that you were a sinner claiming the blood of Christ, the firstborn, to cover your sins? Like Adam and Eve, our covering is not good enough. In error, Isaac mistook Jacob for his firstborn Esau. But God didn't make a mistake when he covered us with Christ's robe of righteousness. When we are reborn in Christ, we are covered with the robe of the true firstborn. Our identity is in Jesus, and God planned it that way. God calls us according to his own grace, which was given to us in Christ Jesus before time began. That's from 2 Timothy 1, verse 9. Again, God planned it that way. I'd like to close this morning with a verse from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. It reads, "For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him." Praise God for the power of his grace to cover our sins. Let's close with hymn number 412, "Cover with His Life."
Please stand with us.
My life of sin.
us pray. Father, we thank you for your son Jesus. We thank you that he is the firstborn, the one who is rightfully is and deserves the blessings of heaven. He is the one who is called the firstborn of creation, the firstborn of the resurrection. And because he is the firstborn, he can cover our sins with righteousness. However unworthy we are to receive that gift, we thank you for what you have done for us, that you have given us of yourself, that we may live forever with you. We thank you for your righteousness and your blood covering our sins. We pray that you be with us as we go to our homes and never allow us to forget that you are the one who has covered our sins. We ask these things in your name. Amen.